Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Education for Extinction, American Indians and the Boarding School Experience, 1875 to 1928, by David Wallace Adams. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Education for Extinction into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code Identity, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Preface to the second edition. It has now been some 25 years since the publication of Education for Extinction, American Indians and the Boarding School Experience, 1875 to 1928. Over the course of those years, there has been a plethora of outstanding studies on Indian boarding schools by both native and non-native scholars. So when the University Press of Kansas offered me the opportunity to submit a 25th anniversary edition of the book, I agreed, but only on the condition that I fully revise the first edition, encompassing as much as possible the new scholarship on the subject. The product, I believe, offers a richer and more nuanced analysis than the first edition. Those familiar with the first edition will note two significant changes to the earlier book. I include new material on subjects such as the outing program, the connection between boarding schools and World War I, the ghost dance religion, the role of sports, and the multiple patterns and complex responses of students to the system. This new edition also weaves more native voices into the boarding school story. Indeed, one of the chief accomplishments of scholars over recent decades has been to extract more of these voices from the historical record, making it possible to illuminate in richer detail the thoughts and experiences of those who passed through these institutions. Since the original publication of this book, several noted scholars, including Michael C. Coleman, Margaret D. Jacobs, Kim Carey Warren, and Andrew Wolford, have written outstanding comparative studies that address the subject in an international and/or ethno-racial context. In its own way, my study, Three Roads to Magdalena, Coming of Age on a Southwest Borderland, 1890 to 1990, is comparative in nature. While I believe that such comparative studies bring to the discussion valuable perspectives, I have generally avoided the comparative lens for reasons of space. I wish to offer a special thanks to William J. Reese, Brian S. Collier, and an anonymous native historian who offered valuable advice and enthusiastic support for undertaking this revision. I am also indebted to the native scholar Clifford E. Trafzer for the concept of turning the power that captures so well the resilience of those indigenous children who managed not only to endure the boarding school experience, but also to build upon it in the pursuit of political and cultural aims at variance with the institution's aims. In the first edition's preface, I wrote that my original interest in the subject began when I was a small child growing up in Southern California, when the family would occasionally drive past Sherman Institute, one of the last of the off-reservation boarding schools. My interest, I explained, stemmed from my father's explanation that Indian children went to that school, which might be many hundreds of miles from their homes. As a child, I found it incomprehensible that children would be going to school so far from their parents. Something about it seemed terribly unnatural. After sharing this story, I have been asked many times about this memory, to the point that I began to wonder whether it was entirely accurate. had I perhaps misremembered it? And then, several years ago, I happened to mention to a cousin that I would be attending a conference at Sherman Institute, now Sherman Indian High School. Her response? Sherman Institute? Growing up, all you talked about was that damn Indian school. And so, here it is. After another 25 years, I'm still thinking about those damn Indian schools. Preface to the first edition. In some respects, the idea for this book originated some 45 years ago. Growing up in Southern California's Inland Empire, or Citrus Ranch Country, I frequently had occasion to be part of a family outing to the seacoast, a journey which took us through the community of Riverside. I still recall the keen sense of anticipation I felt when our 1941 pale green Pontiac sedan made the diagonal turn from Market Street onto Magnolia Avenue, bordered by huge, stately palms and pungent-smelling eucalyptus and pepper trees. Magnolia would take us past Sherman Institute, the Indian school. In a few minutes, it appeared, an impressive institution built in the Mission Revival architectural style characteristic of turn-of-the-century California. So Indians lived and went to school here. The idea fascinated me, and even though I rarely caught a glimpse of a real Indian, several questions came to mind. Why was this school located in Riverside, a community seemingly devoid of Indians? What was it like to be an Indian in such a school? Didn't they miss their parents? What happened when they got sick? Did they go to church? What, in fact, were they thinking and feeling? Our Pontiac sped on, the Spanish red-tiled roofs disappearing among the row of gray-green palms and eucalyptus. But the questions never went away. Finally, after nearly 20 years of research, I think I have some answers. This study is the story of how policymakers sought to use the schoolhouse, specifically the boarding schools, as an instrument for acculturating Indian youths to American ways of thinking and living. The study has a three-tiered focus. On one level, it is a study of policy formulation, how reformers and government officials came to look upon education as a central feature of the new Indian policy. Second, it offers a detailed analysis of how educational policy was translated into institutional practice, describing the entire process whereby Indian agents, school superintendents, teachers, and staff went about the business of civilizing Indian youths. Finally, it describes how students responded to these efforts, including the story of what happened when they returned to their reservation homes. For several reasons, this project turned out to be a much bigger undertaking than originally anticipated. For one thing, this study is comprehensive in scope. Although utilizing case studies to illustrate larger themes, this book is not about a single institution or Indian group. From the beginning, I rejected this approach in the belief that the paucity of Indian source material required a much broader perspective if the larger patterns of student response were to be discerned. This assumption, it turns out, was well-founded. The only schools specifically exempted from this study are those associated with the so-called five civilized tribes, a story sufficiently unique as to require a separate investigation altogether, a project I leave to others. Second, I clearly underestimated the amount of published scholarship having direct bearing on some particular aspect of my inquiry. In the course of my research, I have had to explore such diverse subjects as cross-cultural gender roles, the function of rituals, The Anthropology of Sport, Native American Spirituality, Acculturation Theory, Indian Health Issues, and the Nature of Total Institutions. Finally, there were those times when I faced the difficulty of making even superficial generalizations on subjects that I expected, mistakenly as it turns out, to be fairly well-trod territory. I was surprised to discover, for instance, that even though historians have written voluminously on the background of teachers who went south to teach freed men during the Reconstruction era, not a single scholarly article exists on the background and experience of teachers, mostly women, who joined the Indian school service. A word on voice, or rather, voices. I have written this book with a sort of double consciousness. On the one hand, I have attempted to lay bare the social and ideological outlook of those whites responsible for the creation of the boarding school system. Only when one understands reformers' assumptions and beliefs about the nature and fate of Indian America, I would argue, can one appreciate the full meaning of the educational programs they prescribed and designed. For this reason, in the early chapters especially, the words civilization, civilize, savagism, and savage are widely used throughout the text, not because they offer an accurate description of the cultural dichotomies or processes involved, but rather because they represent the deep-seated ethnocentric, if not racist, vision of the policymakers. At the same time, this book seeks to describe in as realistic fashion as possible the nature and meaning of the boarding school experience from the Indian student's perspective. As any historian well knows, the problems involved in giving voice to Indians, a group for whom the documentary record is both sparse and unreliable, are legion. The additional challenge involved in representing the experience of a subgroup of this population, Indian children, seemed at times almost insurmountable. Whether I have succeeded in this effort is for the listener to decide. One thing is for certain. My childhood fascination with the Indian school, and by extension with all Indian schools, was justified, established for the sole purpose of severing the child's cultural and psychological connection to his native heritage. This unique institution figured prominently in the federal government's desire to find a solution to the Indian problem, a method of saving Indians by destroying them. Years later, when I would come to know and work with Native Americans, their stories confirmed what I had long suspected. Attending boarding schools had been one of the defining experiences of their lives. The story needs to be told. In the process of researching and writing, I have benefited from the aid and advice of numerous individuals and institutions. First, I owe an inestimable debt of gratitude to the archivists and librarians at the following institutions: the National Archives, the Smithsonian Institution, the Beinecke Rare Book and Manuscript Library, Yale University, Hampton University, Sherman Institute Museum, Phoenix Indian School, Haskell Indian Nations University, University of New Mexico, Indiana University, Arizona Historical Society, Elizabeth M. Watkins Community Museum, Lawrence, Kansas, and the Cleveland Public Library. I owe a special thanks to Cleveland State University, which has, over the years, generously supported my research efforts. Finally, I owe the deepest debt of gratitude to my wife, Vicky, and our three children, Jason, Nathaniel, and Amanda, for allowing me to devote countless evenings, weekends, and summers to this project. Prologue, 1882. For Herbert Welsh and Henry Pancoast, the journey from Philadelphia to Chicago had been ordinary enough. The railroad cars filled with middle-class passengers traveling from one great American city to another on the threshold of greatness. But the atmosphere on the westbound train out of Chicago was altogether different. Their traveling companions were now a much cruder lot. Black-bearded Westerners, gamblers, Iowa farmers, Norwegian and German immigrants. And then there was the endless space. Between Philadelphia and Chicago, the landscape had been speckled with farms, churches, and schoolhouses. Now there were few signs of civilization. All day we pushed steadily into the level silence. Pancoast later wrote, "Yet at sunset there was nothing to tell us we had advanced a foot. The only change was that from long, flat, treeless stretches to a more undulating country, where the mighty plain gathers itself in grassy swells, full of free, delicious curves and soft hollows. Now there was just the land, but someday there would be more, much more. Meanwhile, the earth seemed waiting, after the primeval fashion, for man to come in and possess it. And slowly, gradually, it was being possessed. The signs of civilization were already there, in the occasional cluster of immigrant shacks, the land offices, and the plows being unloaded at railroad junctions, and soon there would be farms, churches, and schools. Such was the nature of progress. Finally, the smoking locomotive pulled into Chamberlain in Dakota Territory. Here, on the eastern bank of the Missouri River, the railroad and white civilization itself came to an abrupt halt. But Welsh and Pancoast, both Philadelphia lawyers, were going still farther west. For on the other side of the fierce waters of the Missouri is another race and another order of things. Sioux country. The decision to make the trip west had actually been Welsh's idea. As the nephew of William Welsh, a renowned Episcopalian minister and the first chairman of the Board of Indian Commissioners, the younger Welsh had been invited by an old family friend, Bishop William Hare, to view conditions among the Sioux, with whom Hare had labored for years as a missionary. No doubt Hare's motive was to enlist the younger Welsh in the work of Indian reform. If such was the bishop's thinking, it was a stroke of brilliance, for both Welsh and Pancoast were affected deeply by what they saw and were immediately drawn to the cause. Shortly after their return to Philadelphia, both travelers published detailed accounts of their four-week journey. Their separate renderings are instructive, not so much for what they reveal about life among the Sioux, but rather for what they reveal about the sensitivities, beliefs, and values of a new generation of reformers. Both Welsh and Pancoast portrayed Indian-white relations as being at a critical juncture. The rush of Western settlement grows more and more. An enormous army pours continuously into our eastern seaports to spread itself over the West, Pancoast reported. Living a Stone Age existence, Indians could never withstand the never-ending onslaught of white settlement. Furthermore, the tide of progress could not be stopped. Hence, we must either butcher them or civilize them. And what we do, we must do quickly. Welsh and Pancoast were horrified at the former prospect, and their journey had left them with the firm conviction that a reformed Indian policy was capable of transforming backward primitives into fully civilized members of the human race, fit candidates for American citizenship. According to Welsh, the Indian was not a wild beast whose extermination is necessary to the safety of a higher order of creation, but a man for whom honor, purity, knowledge, and love are not only within the range of possibility, but are qualities which already, in numberless instances, have been attained. The two men had caught a glimpse of a new era in the mission schools at Yankton and Santee. After seeing the cultural offspring of Sitting Bull scratch their ABCs on slate tablets and ply newfound carpentry skills, the solution to the Indian question seemed close at hand. For Pancoast, among all my remembrances of Dakota, there is one that has for me a peculiar and serene beauty. The remembrance of one of those wonderful sunsets in the atmosphere of crystal clearness, in front of a schoolhouse, a ring of Indian children playing Jacob and Rachel. I can see now the free, unconscious grace of their motions, and hear the childish giggles and screams of laughter, and the funny little accent with which they shouted, "Jacob and Rachel!" I looked at these children and thought of the hideous record of unrighteous greed and bloody retaliation that makes up the sad story of their race, and of the lives that lay before them that they thought of so little. Yet, to look at them is to hope. Mournful and oppressed as the condition of their race is, it may be that out of the darkness and the bondage, a little child shall lead them. Part 1. Civilization. Chapter 1. Reform. It would be difficult to imagine a hypothetical instance of cultural conflict more fundamental than that which occurred in the 17th century when European Americans first made contact with Native Americans along the Atlantic seaboard. In the next 200 years, as whites pushed farther west, the same meeting would occur on successive frontiers. Cultural interaction and conflict are always subtle and complex processes, but they are not always as devastatingly one-sided as in the case of indigenous-white relations. As the Iroquois and Shawnee and the Arapaho would all eventually discover, the white man's superior technology, hunger for land, and ethnocentrism seemingly knew no bounds. The threat came in many forms: smallpox, missionaries, Conestoga wagons, barbed wire, and smoking locomotives. And in the end, it came in the form of schools. In the 1790s, no question was more pressing for the new national government than that of deciding the future status of Indians. The policy issue could be reduced to this fact: Indians possessed the land, and whites wanted the land. In addressing this dilemma, the early architects of federal Indian policy never doubted that the vast wilderness stretching to the west would one day fall into white hands. It was not simply a matter of greed. On the contrary, the very survival of the Republic demanded that Indians be dispossessed of their land. According to prevailing Republican theory, only a society built upon the broad foundation of private property could guarantee public morality, political independence, and social stability. It followed that the fate of the Republic was inextricably linked to an almost endless supply of free or cheap land. And if the nation possessed anything, it possessed an inexhaustible supply of land, or rather, Indians possessed it. For the founders of a settler nation, a major priority was the creation of a mechanism and rationale for divesting Indians of their lands. The matter was especially delicate and problematic because even though the divestiture of Indian land was essential to the extension of American ideals, That divestiture must also be ultimately justified by those same ideals. In the search for a resolution to this dilemma, policymakers were served well by long-standing images of Indians and their life ways. Basic to all perceptions was the conclusion that because Indian cultural patterns were vastly different from those of whites, they must be inferior. Whether discussing the Indians' worship of pagan gods, their simple tribal organization, or their dependency on wild game for subsistence, white observers found Indian society wanting. Indian life, it was argued, constituted a lower order of human society. In a word, Indians were savages because they lacked the very thing whites possessed, civilization. And because the law of historical progress and the doctrine of social evolution meant that civilized ways were destined to triumph over savagism, Indians would ultimately confront a fateful choice: civilization or extinction. And there was little doubt that the race would choose civilized ways over savage ways. Wasn't civilization preferable to savagism? Wasn't life preferable to death? Viewing Indian-white relations in this context, policymakers were prepared to resolve the land question. Again, the answer lay in the Indians' civilization. Noting that the approach of white civilization always depleted the supply of wild game available to adjacent Indian populations, policymakers reasoned that the race would find it in their self-interest to take up sedentary agriculture. Moreover, once transformed into farmers, they would require less land, which would then become available to whites. In 1803, President Thomas Jefferson observed that this ongoing process was, in fact, producing a coincidence of interests between the races. Indians, having land in abundance, needed civilization. Whites possessed civilization, but needed land. Upon this convenient conjoinment of greed and philanthropy, an Indian policy slowly emerged. In 1818, the House Committee on Indian Affairs urged Congress, "Put into the hands of their children the primer and the hoe, and they will naturally, in time, take hold of the plow, and as their minds become enlightened and expand, the Bible will be their book, and they will grow up in habits of morality and industry, leave the chase to those whose minds are less cultivated, and become useful members of society." A year later, Congress created the Civilization Fund, an annual appropriation of $10,000 to be administered by Thomas L. McKinney, the nation's first superintendent of Indian affairs. By 1825, 38 Indian schools were in operation, mainly run by missionary societies. An exception was the remarkable Choctaw Academy in Great Crossings, Kentucky, a joint effort of the federal government and the Choctaw Nation, who looked to education as a means of preparing young tribal members for life in an encroaching white world. Over the course of 23 years, the school would draw students from 17 nations and enroll some 600 children. But over time, the civilization program proved unequal to the challenge at hand. Insufficient resources, the onrush of land-hungry frontiersmen, and the native assumption that Indian students, once instructed in the ways of civilization, would readily shed their cultural skins for white ones, all contributed to disappointing results. These factors caused some observers to conclude what many had maintained all along: Indians might in fact be incapable of transformation and thus were destined for extinction. For writers and artists, there were endless metaphors and images to describe what was transpiring on the frontier. Indians, like the melting snow in the morning sunlight, like forest leaves withering in the chill air of autumn, like wild beasts retreating before the sound of the settler's axe, were a vanishing race. By the late 1820s, political leadership was searching for a short-term policy that would simultaneously serve the demands of both empire and philanthropy. The result was Indian removal. Beyond the Mississippi, it was argued, Indians might, for a time, live according to their preferred customs. But more important, with the help of the government and missionaries, they would continue to make progress in learning the ways of civilization, unmolested now by the avarice of land-hungry whites. Unfortunately, demarcations intended to restrict Indian-white contact never lasted for long. In the 1840s, Oregon land fever and dreams of California gold were sufficient motivations to prompt settlers, miners, and other frontier types to breach the Indian barrier. What began as a trickle soon became a flood, and the nomadic tribes of the Central Plains, whose fragile lifeways were enmeshed with the vast stretches of prairie grass and the great bison herds, found their way of life threatened as well. In 1851, 10,000 warriors, among them the Sioux, the Cheyenne, and the Arapaho, gathered on the far western plains near Fort Laramie in what would become Wyoming Territory, signed a treaty by the same name, and agreed for the first time to live within specified boundaries. After the Civil War, the coming of the railroad, the telegraph, and a network of military forts further constricted the Indians' freedom of movement. Homesteaders and cattlemen were close behind. Conflict was inevitable, and it came regularly in the form of 30 years of intermittent but bloody warfare. And then, as one tribe after another was crushed on the battlefield, after the great bison herds were all but exterminated, it was suddenly over. Settler expansion, broken treaties, ethnic cleansing, and on occasion, outright genocide had all taken their toll on indigenous America. A new phase of Indian policy was slowly emerging, the reservation system. In 1871, Congress officially confirmed the altered status of Indians. They were deemed to be wards of the government. Indians were now a colonized people. These developments did not escape the notice and wrath of philanthropic observers who decried not so much the Indians' altered status as much as the often cruel and brutal manner in which it had been accomplished. Critics also focused on the mounting evidence that the Office of Indian Affairs, commonly known as the Indian Office or Indian Bureau, the division within the Department of the Interior charged with the administration of Indian affairs, was riddled with corruption from top to bottom. The result of these criticisms was the celebrated but short-lived peace policy announced by President Ulysses S. Grant in 1869. The peace policy was three-pronged. Henceforth, agency or reservation personnel would be appointed by church boards of the various religious denominations. Federal support for educational programs would be expanded, and the president would appoint a group of eminent philanthropists to serve as the Board of Indian Commissioners, whose responsibility it would be to independently review and to jointly administer Indian policy with the Secretary of the Interior. But the new policy had scarcely gotten off the ground before it collapsed. Politicians, who coveted the Indian service, including the division of the school service as an endless source of patronage, and the Indian office, which frowned on any attempt to reduce its control over the administration of Indian affairs, almost immediately began a campaign to frustrate and emasculate the power of the church boards to appoint agency officials. Similarly, the scope of authority for the Board of Indian Commissioners was shortly curtailed to that of issuing periodic advisory reports. All in all, little changed. By the early 1880s, a chorus of voices from the pulpit, press, and Congress were again calling for a major overhaul of Indian policy. Several factors now aided the cause of reform. First, during the peace policy era, the issue of Indian policy had competed for attention with the issues of Reconstruction. By the late 1870s, this was no longer the case. Indeed, now policymakers could focus on accomplishing what historians have termed the Greater Reconstruction, integrating both the West and the South into the social, economic, and political fabric of the nation. Second, with Indians all but completely subjugated, talk of a military solution seemed increasingly inhumane to everyone except the most virulent Indian hater. Press stories now frequently described heart-rending accounts of Indian suffering in the American West. The attempt of a band of Poncas to reach their former home on the banks of the Missouri, the desperate and futile fight of the Northern Cheyenne from a hated reservation in Indian territory, and the efforts of Chief Joseph and his band of Nez Perce to retain their home in the cherished Wallawa Valley. Such stories were poignant reminders that the nation's Indian policy was based on shaky moral principles. Finally, reformers found a powerful spokesperson for their cause in Helen Hunt Jackson. In 1881, Jackson's A Century of Dishonor, a sketch of the United States government's dealings with some of the Indian tribes, recounted 100 years of government deceit in Indian affairs and concluded that the nation's treatment of the Indian constituted a dark and bloody stain on the nation's honor. Few were prepared to argue otherwise. By 1880, something approaching a consensus had emerged on the Indian question. Public discussions of the issue now increasingly concluded with the judgment that the government's treatment of its Indian wards had been unnecessarily short-sighted, harsh, and even cruel. It was time for a change. Not surprisingly, as discussion turned to the future, an old and familiar theme reasserted itself. Indians needed to be saved not only from the white man, but also from themselves. In the beginning, it was remembered, Indians had been promised the gift of civilization in exchange for their land. Indian land, for the most part, was now white land. Indians, however, were still largely savages. It was time to redeem an old promise. As reformers struggled to reorient Indian policy, tribal elders reflected on all that had taken place. So much had changed, and it had happened so quickly. The land was gone. The buffalo were gone. The old ways were dying. There seemed to be no end to it. And what ordeals lay ahead? "I know that my race must change," said Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce. "We cannot hold our own with the white man as we are." But how much change? Must hunters take up the plow? Must the sacred ways of the ancestors be thrown over for the black book of the missionary? And what of the children? Perhaps that was the most difficult question of all. What would become of the children? The answer was not long in coming. The New Reformers. Herbert Welsh and Henry Pancoast had scarcely returned from their sojourn among the Sioux in the fall of 1882 than they took up the cause of Indian reform. As Welsh later recalled, the journey had resulted in two firm conclusions. First, that Indians were capable of being assimilated into the mainstream of American life, and second, that the only barrier to achieve this objective was the lack of a sustained political will to do so. What was needed, the two men concurred, was a new organization devoted to molding political opinion along philanthropic lines. Toward this end, Welsh invited some 30 individuals of like persuasion to his Philadelphia home to consider the matter. The result was a new reform organization, the Indian Rights Association. The association, according to an early publication, sought to secure the civilization of the 290,000 Indians of the United States, inclusive of the 30,000 natives of Alaska, and to prepare the way for their absorption into the common life of our own people. For several reasons, the Indian Rights Association soon established itself as the most influential force on the reform scene. Foremost, there was the indefatigable energy and organizational abilities of Welsh, the association's director, whose capacity for speech-making and correspondence knew no bounds. Beyond Welsh's determined capacity were the coordinated strategies adopted by the association to exert pressure on policymakers. Believing that the path to reform lay in galvanizing public opinion, the association, through its annual reports and special reports on selected issues, was soon turning out a steady stream of position statements on all aspects of Indian policy. A particularly unique feature of the association's work was that it periodically conducted investigations of conditions in the field. Whereas other reform organizations could speak with moral authority on the broad question of reform, the Indian Rights Association was able to address specific issues and events at the agency level, often possessing facts more accurate than those available to the Indian office. Finally, the association maximized its political influence by maintaining a full-time lobbyist in Washington, D.C. Over the years, Charles C. Painter, Francis E. Loop, and Samuel M. Brosius would serve in this post, patiently waiting in the outer office of the Commissioner of Indian Affairs or a congressman to press a point of interest. The Indian Rights Association, although the single most important reform body, was not the only one. In fact, by late 1883, it was one of five such organizations dedicated to resolving the Indian problem along philanthropic lines. The oldest of these bodies, the Board of Indian Commissioners, was a holdover from the peace policy era. Although the board by the mid-1870s had been stripped of most of its powers, reduced to the ritual of issuing annual reports on the status of Indian affairs, it helped lay the groundwork for the new reform agenda. Thus, when reform fever reached a new height in the early 1880s, the Board of Indian Commissioners was well prepared to assume a place of significance within the philanthropic network. Two other reform organizations made their appearance in 1879. The Boston Indian Citizenship Association was the direct outgrowth of the public fury surrounding the forced removal of the much-abused Punkas from their Dakota homeland. After launching a successful petition effort on behalf of the Punkas, the new association, led by Massachusetts Governor John D. Long, Helen Hunt Jackson, and U.S. Senator Henry L. Dawes turned its attention to ways of achieving a long-term solution to the Indian question based upon the recognition of Indian treaty rights and citizenship. although the Boston-based organization's influence was soon dwarfed by other reform bodies, it helped lay the groundwork for an emerging consensus. Meanwhile, the Women's National Indian Association, WNIA, was formed the same year when a small group of women began meeting in a Baptist church in Philadelphia to discuss reported white invasions of Indian land in the West. Thoroughly imbued with the spirit of evangelical Protestantism, the small gathering was slowly transformed into a national, non-denominational women's organization devoted to the cause of Indian uplift and assimilation. Members of the WNIA viewed their Indian work as a field of activity particularly suited to the women's sphere, a logical extension of the moral authority embodied in society's idealization of motherhood. The association was soon sending petitions to lawmakers, issuing pamphlets, supporting missionary efforts, providing Christmas gifts for Indian school children, and stocking Indian school libraries with uplifting books. As a means of keeping its members and other reformers abreast of the organization's multiple activities, it launched its own periodical, The Indian's Friend, in 1888. A special concern of WNIA was the education of Indian girls who, as future mothers and homemakers, were perceived as being central to the long-term business of cultural transformation. In this ever-expanding network of reform organizations devoted to the Indian cause, Welsh's Indian Rights Association became the fourth such organization when it formed in early 1883. Because of the sheer scope of its activity, Welsh's organization would become the dominant reform body in the field. But even after its appearance, reformers realized that the network for reform remained incomplete. Still needed was a public forum where reformers could come together for the purpose of translating the emerging consensus into concrete policy recommendations. This need was met in 1883 with the initiation of the so-called Lake Mohonk Conferences. The idea that reformers should come together for an annual meeting on the Indian question was the inspiration of Albert K. Smiley, a prominent Quaker philanthropist and member of the Board of Indian Commissioners. As the owner of a luxurious resort on New York's picturesque Lake Mohonk, Smiley decided to invite prominent philanthropists, government officials, missionaries, and even military figures to his plush hotel for several days of discussion and debate. Beginning in the fall of 1883 and continuing for over 30 years thereafter, these meetings would be attended faithfully by all those interested in the Indian question. Styling themselves as Friends of the Indian, participants engaged in freewheeling discussion and concluded deliberations by passing resolutions calling for specific policy reforms. The annual proceedings of the conference were subsequently published and distributed to the press and to Congress. Next to Welsh's Indian Rights Association, the Lake Mohonk conferences were the most influential force on the reform scene. When reformers gathered at Lake Mohonk, they had much more in common than their vision of Indian policy reform. Well-educated and financially secure, almost to a person, they came from the upper echelons of Eastern society. Furthermore, while representing a number of religious denominations, they were almost universally guided by the tenets of evangelical Protestantism, never doubting for a moment that their effort to uplift Indians was a fulfillment of their Christian obligation to extend the blessings of Christianity to all peoples of the world. Finally, they subscribed to a body of principles that, taken together, constituted the bedrock of mainstream American cultural outlook, what one historian has termed the Protestant Republican ideology. As described by Carl F. Kazel, core elements in this ideology included the following beliefs: the sacredness and fragility of the Republican polity, including ideas about individualism, liberty, and virtue, the importance of individual character in fostering social mobility, the central role of personal industry in defining rectitude and merit, the delineation of a highly respected but limited domestic role for women, the importance for character building of familial and social environment within certain racial and ethnic limitations, the sanctity and social virtues of property, the equality and abundance of economic opportunity in the United States, the superiority of American Protestant culture, the grandeur of America's destiny, and the necessity of a determined public effort to unify America's polyglot population, chiefly through education. Reformers' efforts to assimilate Indian peoples would be shaped in very fundamental ways by their adherence to these principles. It was partly because reformers operated well within the ideological context of 19th century America that they proved to be so successful. And this suggests another fundamental characteristic of the emerging consensus, namely, its pervasiveness. For while it is true that philanthropic organizations would provide much of the moral energy for the reform effort, it is also true that most of their views were readily accepted by policymakers and the public at large. To be sure, there would always be points of tension between reformers and the Indian Office, but on the broad aims of Indian policy, there would be essential agreement. Moreover, the philanthropic consensus came to embrace much of the Indian service as well, from the Secretary of the Interior down to, although to a lesser extent, the agency employee in the field. But to understand the basis for this consensus, it is not enough to know that the Indian problem cried out for solution, that reformers were well organized, or that they operated within the mainstream ideological tradition of American culture. In the end, this consensus was rooted in an idea almost deeper than ideology itself. The key word was civilization. European and American societies were civilized. Indians were savages. The idea functioned at several levels, or rather, served several purposes. On one level, it operated as assumption. Philanthropists simply assumed that because Indian ways differed from white ways, therefore, they must be less civilized. On another level, the idea served as a legitimizing rationale for the hegemonic relationship that had come to characterize Indian-white relations. In this connection, it served as a compelling justification for dispossessing Indians of their land. Finally, the idea was prescriptive. It told philanthropists what Indians must become and, as we shall see shortly, to what end they should be educated. The idea of civilization had always been an underlying assumption of the nation's Indian policy. Again, the basic assumption was that all societies could be classified on a scale marking the various stages of man's evolution from savagism to civilization. Through historical and environmental circumstances, and, some argued, by divine intent, America had managed to reach the uppermost stage in cultural development. Under the proper conditions, that is to say, under white tutelage, Indians too might one day become as civilized as their white brothers. Indeed, the idea of civilization embodied within itself one of the most cherished ideas of the 18th and 19th centuries, the idea of progress. History, from this perspective, was largely the story of man's progressive evolution toward civilized perfection. This progression was both inevitable and desirable, for civilization, especially Christian civilization, gave expression to man's noblest sentiments. From all this, it followed that just as savagism must give way to civilization, so Indian ways must give way to white ways. For some Americans, it was simply in the natural order of things, one of those natural laws applied to the affairs of men. For others, it was a question of the nation fulfilling its divine mission. For most, it was a question of both. One only needed to look at the course of American expansion to see the scale of civilization and its corollary, the doctrine of progress, vividly displayed. If the history of America was anything, it was the progressive triumph of civilization over savagism. As Jefferson observed in 1824, "Let a philosophic observer commence a journey from the savages of the Rocky Mountains eastwardly towards our seacoast. These he would observe in the earliest stage of association, living under no law but that of nature, subsisting and covering themselves with the flesh and the skins of beasts. He would next find those on our frontiers in the pastoral state, raising domestic animals to supply the defects of hunting, then succeed our own semi-barbarous citizens, the pioneers of the advance of civilization, and so, in his progress, he would meet the gradual shades of improving man until he would reach his, as yet, most improved state in our seaport towns. This, in fact, is equivalent to a survey, in time, of the progress of man from the infancy of creation to the present day." As the scholar Roy Harvey Pierce has perceptively observed, for Jefferson and his contemporaries, the history of American civilization was seen as being a three-dimensional affair, progressing from past to present, from east to west, from lower to higher. The idea of social evolution received authoritative verification in 1877 with the publication of Lewis Henry Morgan's Ancient Society, or Researches in the Lines of Human Progress from Savagery Through Barbarism to Civilization. In this seminal work, Morgan set out to identify the various stages in cultural evolution in addition to the factors, both institutional and ideational, that characterized each successive stage. Morgan calculated that there were 7 ethical periods in all, and that all peoples on the globe could be placed somewhere on this scale: lower savagery, middle savagery, upper savagery, lower barbarism, middle barbarism, upper barbarism, and civilization. Depending on the particular tribal group, American Indian societies were classified as being at the level of either upper savagery, lower barbarism, or, in a few instances, middle barbarism. In no instance had an Indian people ever achieved civilization, but it was inevitable that they would eventually do so. As Morgan explained, each society had within itself the germ of progressive evolution. By the universal law of social progress, therefore, all peoples would someday join the ranks of the civilized. The reasons for the Indian's lowly position on Morgan's scale becomes clear when considering his requirements for civilized status. Under Morgan's scheme, societies were ranked according to their level of technical and material development, their subsistence patterns, the complexity of their institutional arrangements, and finally, their ideas, passions, and aspirations. Two evolutionary developments were of particular significance. The first of these was the monogamous nuclear family. This development was crucial because it contributed to firmly fixed ideas of familial responsibility, reflected a higher sense of moral understanding, and established clearer lines for the inheritance of property. The second key development, and in many ways the linchpin to the wheel of progress, was the idea of property. Without the conception of private property, a society's social, economic, and political institutions would be forever stunted. In Morgan's words, "Its dominance as a passion over all other passions marks the commencement of civilization." By this standard, and for that matter by all others as well, Indians failed the test of civilization. But again, in time, all this could change. It is not clear how many reformers actually read Morgan's Ancient Society, but it is safe to say that the widespread publicity surrounding the book helped fortify the intellectual framework within which they operated. In any case, the idea of civilization pervaded reformers' thinking. When William Torrey Harris, the U.S. Commissioner of Education, addressed the Lake Mohonk Conference, he placed the Indian problem in a context wholly familiar to his audience. After asking whether a member of Indian society was civilized, he answered, "No. He is at the tribal stage. He is at the patriarchal stage. Civilization below the patriarchal stage would not be above the brutes. Above that comes the village community, and many who believe in socialism would like to have us go back to that. Above the village community comes feudalism, wherein the individual is ground into subordination so that division of labor can be established. No yellow race has passed through it. The black race has not passed through it, except as it has come into the house of bondage. The nations of Europe and America have passed through it. It is a great thing to go through these stages." As Harris went on to explain, attributes of civilization included a commitment to the values of individualism, industry, and private property, the acceptance of Christian doctrine and morality, including the Christian ideal of the family, the abandonment of loyalty to the tribal community for a higher identification with the state as an independent citizen, the willingness to become both a producer and consumer of material goods, and finally, an acceptance of the idea that man's conquest of nature constituted one of his noblest accomplishments. The idea of civilization pervaded not only the discussions at Lake Mohonk, but the entire Indian Bureau. Thus, when the agent to the Utes at White River Agency, Colorado, expressed his frustration at getting his Indians to adopt civilized pursuits, he noted, "Civilization has been reached by successive stages. First was the savage, clearly that of these Utes. Next, the pastoral, to which a few have now extended. Next, the barbaric, and finally, the enlightened, scientific, and religious." For this agent, there were apparently four rungs on the ladder to civilization. Most agents were either unable or chose not to spell out in detail the exact number of stages that Indians would have to pass through on their climb to civilization. For most, it was simply a case of trying to civilize savages. Thus, the agent to one of the Pueblo villages of New Mexico was moved to note, "To this indigenous race, the conquests of civilization are unknown, and the law of progress utterly void." Just as philanthropists in Jefferson's time had offered Indians a choice about their ultimate fate, so the new generation of policymakers did the same. Thus, Carl Schurz, a former commissioner of Indian Affairs, concluded in 1881 that Indians were confronted with this stern alternative: extermination or civilization. In the same decade, Secretary of the Interior Lucius Q. Lamar pronounced that the only alternative now presented to the American Indian race is speedy entrance into the pale of American civilization or absolute extinction. Similarly, Commissioner of Indian Affairs Henry Price opined, "Savage and civilized life cannot live and prosper on the same ground. One of the two must die." Certainly, reformers hoped that Indians would choose assimilation over extinction. As the former commissioner Schurz observed, the idea of exterminating a race, once the only occupant of the soil upon which so many millions of our own people have grown prosperous and happy, must be revolting to every American who is not devoid of all sentiments of justice and humanity. One way or another, the Indians' fate would be decided in the very near future. Time was quickly running out on savagism. Whereas Indians historically had been able to retreat before the moving line of civilization, the onrush of technology and white settlements had finally caught up with them. Great stretches of the prairie were now being churned by the settler's plow. The once still prairie air was now alive with the hum of telegraph lines and the locomotive's whistle. The rich grasslands, which had once fed vast buffalo herds, now supported the white man's thriving cattle industry. And what was the Indian to do in the face of this flowing tide of civilization? As Commissioner of Indian Affairs John Oberle noted, there was little the Indian could do. The forests into which he had once run whooping had all but been felled. The game on which he lived has disappeared. The warpath has been obliterated. He is hemmed in on all sides by white population. An Indian school superintendent in Kansas painted much the same scenario. Gradually have their possessions dwindled, reservation after reservation disappearing before the invincible march of civilization, till now their domain is reckoned in acres instead of continents, and is bounded by surveyors' chains and links instead of oceans, gulfs, and lakes. And once again the conclusion, the only alternative left is civilization or annihilation, absorption or extermination. Because time was clearly running out for the Indians, time was running out for reformers as well. Whereas earlier efforts to civilize the Indians were, in the words of Schurz, a benevolent fancy, it now had become an absolute necessity if we mean to save them. And reformers remained optimistic that Indians could be saved. With public sentiment aroused and with philanthropic organizations working in concert with policymakers, there was still time to accomplish the Indians' absorption into American life. Reformers were also of one mind as to what was needed. The solution to the Indian problem lay in three areas: land, law, and education. The land issue was linked to what reformers regarded as the biggest obstacle to Indian assimilation, the reservation system. The reservation was deplored for three reasons. First, it perpetuated the Indians' attachment to the tribal outlook and tribal institutions. Most notable in this regard was the high value placed on communal property holding and gift-giving, traditions that reformers viewed as anathemas to the emergence of self-reliant individualism. Second, the reservation was inextricably linked to the rationing system, which, although well-intentioned, had the practical result of instilling an attitude of dependency. Rather than relying on their own manhood for survival, Indians now saw the Great Father as the source of all their earthly needs. Finally, under the reservation system, Indians had little motivation to invest their labor in a farm that might be swept away in a new Indian removal program. As Welsh explained, an Indian labors with no assurance whatsoever that he shall enjoy the scanty fruits of his toil, for no sooner has he abandoned the tent of roving day and built himself a rude cabin of logs and begun to gladden the ground about his dwelling with a little crop of corn and wheat and potatoes than the greedy eye of some white neighbor spies his success, and Congress knows no peace until he is driven westward. For these reasons, Lyman Abbott pronounced, the reservation had to be uprooted root, trunk, branch, and leaf, and a new system put in its place. The solution, reformers argued, lay in the allotment of Indian land in severalty. Allotment would smash the tribal connection, force Indians to work the land, and eventually bring an end to the rationing system. In 1887, Congress passed the General Allotment Act, more commonly referred to as the Dawes Act, named after its sponsor, Henry Dawes, the venerable senator from Massachusetts. Under the new legislation, the president was authorized to identify selected reservations suitable for allotment, after which the following provisions were initiated. First, the reservation was surveyed and divided up among the Indians, 160 acres to each family head, 80 acres to single persons and orphans over 18 years, and 40 acres to single persons under 18. Second, to protect allottees from avaricious whites, the actual deed to the allotment remained in the hands of the government for 25 years, during which time the land could not be sold or encumbered. Third, citizenship status was conferred upon all allottees, whereupon they would become subject to the criminal and civil laws of the state or territory where they resided. Finally, after all tribal members had received an allotment, all surplus land might be sold to white settlers. The proceeds gained from these sales would be held by the government for the tribe's education and civilization. Reformers viewed the Dawes Act as a major victory. In one bold stroke, it held out the possibility of smashing the tribal bond and setting Indians on the road to civilization. The second plank of the reformers' platform was to extend the rule and protection of the nation's legal system to Indians. The Dawes Act would facilitate this, but what about those Indians still caught in the backwaters of reservation life? For reformers, the answer was obvious. Since laws and courts were civilizing influences, they must be extended to the reservations. The creation of the Reservation Indian Police Force in 1878 was a first step. As this system was set up, Indian policemen were selected from the ranks of cooperative tribesmen, given a badge of authority, and pledged to carry out the directives of the reservation agent, which ranged from supervising the distribution of annuity goods to arresting Indians charged with crimes. Another step was taken in 1883 when Congress provided for the creation of Indian courts to try cases involving minor crimes such as polygamy, theft, and participation in heathenish dances. Reformers won still another victory in 1885 when Congress extended the jurisdiction of federal courts over Indian reservations for major crimes such as murder, manslaughter, rape, and arson. Although these measures were important, reformers were constantly looking for new ways to bring Indians under the civilizing influence of the white man's law. As the reformer Merrill Gates characterized the issue, the problem before us is, how shall we educate these men children into that great conception of the reign of law, moral, civil, and political, to which they are now strangers? The third area of reform was education. Indians must be taught the knowledge, values, mores, and habits of Christian civilization. The notion that reformers should turn to education as the third plank of policy reform is not surprising. Since the days of the common school movement, the schoolhouse had come to achieve almost mythical status. Reformers viewed it as a seedbed of republican virtues and democratic freedoms, a promulgator of individual opportunity and national prosperity, and an instrument for social progress and harmony. Moreover, because of the common school's alleged ability to assimilate, it was viewed as an ideal instrument for absorbing those peoples and ideologies that stood in the path of the Republic's millennial destiny. Thus, the Board of Indian Commissioners would ask, if the common school is the glory and boast of our American civilization, why not extend its blessings to the 50,000 benighted children of the red men of our country, that they may share its benefits and speedily emerge from the ignorance of the centuries? The case for education was made on several levels. One of the strongest arguments was that the older generation of Indians was incapable of being civilized. As an agent to the Lakota mused, it is a mere waste of time to attempt to teach the average adult Indians the ways of the white man. He can be tamed, and that is about all. The agent to the Shoshone concurred, reporting that the older Indians were making little progress toward civilization. It is not in his mother's milk, he explained, and as it was not born in the bone, it won't come out in the flesh. The only hope, he concluded, was in training the youth. Older Indians might be convinced to live on their allotments and to build houses, might be forced to obey the white man's law, and might even be prohibited from participating in their heathen ceremonies, the argument went. But in their hearts, they remained attached to the old ways. They were likely, as Commissioner Loop explained, to remain Indians of the old school until the grave. But our main hope lies with the youthful generations who are still measurably plastic. The agent to the Utes observed in 1886, it is food for thought to note the number of handsome, bright-eyed children here, typical little savages arrayed in blankets, leggings, and G-strings, their faces hideously painted, growing up in all the barbarism of their parents. A few years more and they will be men and women, perhaps beyond redemption, for, under the most favorable circumstances, but little can be hoped from them after growth and matured, wedded and steeped in the vices of their fathers. It is rather the little children that must be taken in hand and cared for and nurtured, for from them must be realized the dream, if ever realized, of the philanthropist and of all good people, of that day to come when the Indian, a refined, cultured, educated being, will assume the title of an American citizen with all the rights, privileges, and aspirations of that favored individual. Another argument used by school advocates was that education would quicken the process of cultural evolution. Whereas white civilization had taken centuries to emerge to its present level, if Indian school children could gain entrance to the common school, they would enter the struggle of life with roughly the same advantages as the children of their more civilized white neighbors. By means of the common school, Indians could, in effect, be catapulted directly from savagism to civilization, skipping all the intervening stages of social evolution in between. Commissioner of Education, William Torrey Harris, addressed this very issue at Lake Mohonk. After reviewing the stages in man's social evolution, Harris asked, "But shall we say to the tribal people that they shall not come to these higher things unless they pass through all the intermediate stages? Or can we teach them directly these higher things and save them from the slow process of the ages?" The latter course was fully possible, Harris explained. Education has become a great potency in our hands, and we believe that we can now vicariously save them very much that the white race has had to go through. Commissioner of Indian Affairs Thomas J. Morgan had come to the same conclusion. Time, as an element in human progress, is relative, not absolute, he explained. Where Indians were concerned, a good school may thus bridge over for them the dreary chasm of 1,000 years of tedious evolution. Thus, schools could not only civilize, they could civilize in record time. Finally, the case for education was also made on economic grounds. This line of argument took several forms. First, educating Indians promised to relieve the government of the responsibility of feeding and clothing them. Schooling, if it promised to do anything, promised to prepare Indians for economic self-sufficiency. Another argument was that it was less expensive to educate Indians than to kill them. Carl Schurz, for instance, estimated that it cost nearly $1 million to kill an Indian in warfare, whereas it cost only $1,200 to give an Indian child 8 years of schooling. Similarly, Secretary of the Interior Henry Teller calculated that over a 10-year period, the annual cost of both waging war on Indians and providing protection for frontier communities was in excess of $22 million, nearly 4 times what it would cost to educate 30,000 children for a year. A final version of the economic argument was a throwback to Jefferson's idea that Indian ignorance of civilization retarded both white settlement and national prosperity. According to Commissioner Morgan, a wild Indian requires 1,000 acres to roam over, while an intelligent man will find a comfortable support for his family on a very small tract. When the rising generation of Indians have become civilized and have learned how to utilize the land they live on, a vast domain, now useless, can be thrown open to settlement and become the seat of great farms, happy homes, thriving towns and cities, and vast mining and commercial industries. Barbarism is costly, wasteful, and extravagant. Intelligence promotes thrift and increases prosperity. Again, education made economic sense. In constructing their rationale for education, reformers stressed still another point, namely that the success of the two other planks of their platform, allotment and law, were ultimately dependent on schooling for Indians. This was the point that Charles Painter stressed when he announced at Lake Mohonk that the passage of the Dawes Act, although necessary, had also created a crisis in Indian affairs. As Painter explained, under the terms of the Allotment Act, the Indian was about to be thrown into the seething activities of our complex civilization and take his chances in free competition with other races. In their current, untutored state, Painter warned, Indians would never be able to survive that competition without the help of the schoolmaster. A year later, Lyman Abbott expressed similar concerns. After acknowledging the importance of land, law, and education to the Indians' transformation, Abbott declared education to be, by far, the most important problem of the three. John Oberle even argued that philanthropic measures should be sequenced in a particular order. "I would first teach the Indian how to work," Oberle began. "Then I would teach him our ideas of the rights of property and give him lands in severalty. Then I would abolish the reservation system and then make the Indian a citizen and enfranchise him." Education was not only important to the Indian's transformation, it was fundamental. And so, the Friends of the Indian turned to schools as a solution to the Indian problem. Education would give Indians the knowledge and skills necessary for survival in a civilized world. As the Commissioner of Indian Affairs, William Jones, explained, "To educate the Indian in the ways of civilized life is to preserve him from extinction, not as an Indian, but as a human being." It mattered little that Indians might not find the terms entirely satisfactory. Indeed, that was part of the problem. As savages, Indians were incapable of determining what was in their own best interests. In time, reformers reasoned, Indians would come to accept the wisdom of their white benefactors. Aims of education. Convinced that schools were the ultimate solution to the Indian problem, policymakers turned next to the question of educational aims. Once again, the idea of civilization provided the context for the discussion. If the problem with the Indians was that they were savages, then what Indian children needed was a civilized education. As one observer of Indian Affairs pointed out, "The kind of education they are in need of is one that will habituate them to the customs and advantages of civilized life, and at the same time cause them to look with feelings of repugnance on their native state." The first priority was to provide the Indian child with the rudiments of an academic education, including the ability to read, write, and speak the English language. The talking paper of the white man had always impressed Indians as one of their subjugators' most powerful weapons. As reformers saw the issue, the Indians were essentially correct in this perception, because a fundamental difference between civilization and savagism was the former's reliance on the written word and the printed page as a means of recording and preserving the accumulated wisdom of the race. As the superintendent of Indian schools observed in 1887, an Indian's inability to speak another language than his own renders his companionship with civilized man impossible. The same year, Commissioner of Indian Affairs John D.C. Atkins proclaimed, "This language, which is good enough for a white man and a black man, ought to be good enough for the red man." Beyond language instruction, Indian schools should introduce the child to the civilized branches of knowledge, arithmetic, science, history, and the arts, not with the idea that he would master these areas, but rather that he might catch at least a glimpse of the civilized world through books. If the more inquiring student chose to move beyond a superficial introduction to these subjects, so much the better. In the meantime, even an elementary acquaintance held out the promise of liberating the child from the mind-dulling weight of tribal tradition, opening up instead the possibility of discovering the self-directing power of thought. Second, Indians needed to be individualized. In many ways, the issue of individualization went to the very heart of the Indian question. In the philanthropic mind, Indians were savages mainly because tribal life placed a higher value on the tribal community than individual interests. Never was this truer than in the economic realm. tribal society had somehow gotten matters all wrong. Rather than operating on the progressive principle that the whole of society stood to benefit when the individual's acquisitive instincts were given their full play, tribal life was rooted in the idea that the welfare of the community depended upon the individual curbing material desires. Whereas a Protestant American measured an individual's worth by his capacity to accumulate wealth, an Indian did so by what he gave away. This, combined with the Indian's aversion to labor and disdain for private property, went a long way toward explaining their backwardness. As Merrill Gates noted, "There is an utter barbarism in which property has almost no existence. The tribal organization tends to retain men in such barbarism. It is a great step gained when you awaken in an Indian the desire for the acquisition of property of his own by his own honest labor." Education should facilitate individualization in two ways. First, it should teach young Indians how to work. More specifically, it could teach them a host of practical skills and trades that would prepare them for the changed realities of their existence. This meant, in the words of one educator, teaching the Indian boy to till the soil, shove the plane, strike the anvil, and drive the peg, and the Indian girl to do the work of the good and skillful housewife. A school superintendent among the Sioux agreed, noting that "the theory of cramming the Indian youth with textbook knowledge alone has been and always will be a failure. The best education for the Aborigines of our country is that which inspires them to become producers instead of remaining consumers." Thus, a string of textbooks piled up in the storehouses high enough to surround a reservation, if laid side by side, will never educate a being with centuries of laziness instilled in the race. It followed that the sound of the hammer, the swing of the axe, and the rhythm of the bucksaw were just as fundamental, perhaps more so, than the meaningless jargon of textbook makers. But teaching Indians how to work was not enough. In the end, they must be inculcated with the values and beliefs of possessive individualism. They must come to respect the importance of private property. They must internalize the idea of self-reliance, and they must come to realize that the accumulation of personal wealth is a moral obligation. Thus, Superintendent of Indian Schools John Oberle argued in 1888 that a major objective of Indian schools was to wean the student from the degrading communism of the tribal reservation system and to imbue him with the exalting egotism of American civilization so that he will say, "I," instead of "we," and "this is mine," instead of "this is ours." According to Merrill Gates, we need to awaken in him once. In his dull savagery, he must be touched by the wings of the divine angel of discontent. Then he begins to look forward, to reach out. The desire for property of his own may become an intense educating force. The wish for a home of his own awakens him to new efforts. Discontent with the teepee and the starving rations of the Indian camp in winter is needed to get the Indian out of the blanket and into trousers, and trousers with a pocket in them and with a pocket that aches to be filled with dollars. Similarly, Senator Dawes argued that the primary obligation of policymakers was to take the Indian by the hand and set him upon his feet and teach him to stand alone first, then to walk, then to dig, then to plant, then to hoe, then to gather, and then to keep. For Dawes, this last step was the single most important stage in the process of individualization. The third aim of education was to reconstruct indigenous conceptions of home and family. Depending on the culture under their scrutiny, reformers pointed to any number of deficiencies in this regard. Some tribes were matrilineal, with women owning property. Others were polygamous, and in still others, the very definition of family and kinship was so expansive as to render the very idea of family all but non-existent. Also, the concern was the belief that native women were regarded as little more than slaves and suffered from all manner of abuse from their husbands. What reformers were calling for, of course, was the conversion of native societies to the ideal of the patriarchal nuclear family. Once converted to this model, men would take on the role of wage earner and women would achieve the moral authority due them as mothers and exemplars of domesticity and homemaking. Land allotment, because it placed families on individual plots of land, was a first step in this direction, but only a first one. In the end, the effort must be made to penetrate and reconstruct the intimacies of home life, teaching women the proper skills of homemaking and motherhood, and in the process, thereby rescuing them from slave-like drudgery. Toward this purpose, Congress, in 1890, authorized the creation of a field matron program, which sent trained women into reservation communities to instruct their native counterparts in the knowledge and skills of civilized homemaking, as well as to awaken them to the benefits awaiting them once they embraced their special role to play in the empire of the home. But reformers always understood that this mission was far too important to leave to a scattered band of field matrons. Schools, too, had a special role to play. Boys must be taught their role as wage earner, father, and beneficent patriarch. In contrast, as the superintendent at Phoenix Indian Boarding School made clear to a gathering of female students, their gender's destiny was the sweeter, gentler side of life. Building upon this theme, he continued, "The boy is the rough, restless element, full of tireless energy, seeking opportunities for a display of bold, spirited deeds. The girl represents home, quiet rest, and content. She it is who touches our moral nature and makes us gentler, kinder, more manly. The most charming girl in all the world is the broad, generous, sympathetic, the purely unselfish one, the girl who thinks more of others than herself, who is always considerate of the feelings of others." Meanwhile, of course, she must raise the children, scrub the floors, do the wash, and iron the family's clothes. Certainly it wasn't too much to ask in the name of civilization. The fourth aim of Indian education was Christianization. Because the philanthropic movement drew its moral energy from the reformers' quest to create a Protestant America, and because their internalized ethnocentrism caused them to look upon native religious practices as primitive and barbaric remnants of a pre-civilized existence, it is not surprising that the Indians' religious conversion should surface as a major educational objective. As one Indian educator noted, "A really civilized people cannot be found in the world except where the Bible has been sent and the gospel taught. Hence, we believe that the Indians must have, as an essential part of their education, Christian training." It was not simply the philanthropists who wanted to snatch the Indian's soul from a hellish fate. Their commitment to Christianization was also rooted in the assumption that civilization, as the highest stage of man's social evolution, was only possible when erected upon a firm foundation of Christian morality. It was not a simple matter of happenstance, they argued, that American civilization was also a Christian society. As William T. Harris told his audience at Lake Mohonk, Christianity was not merely a religion, but an ideal of life penetrating the whole social structure. Thus, it was not enough for Indians to abandon their childish faith in medicine bundles or spirit guides and then profess allegiance to the white man's God. On the contrary, embracing Christianity meant embracing an entire ethical code that included, among other things, the principle that an individual was responsible for both his economic and spiritual self. The fifth aim of Indian schooling was citizenship training. As the Commissioner of Indian Affairs said in 1890, "The general purpose of the government is the preparation of Indian youth for assimilation into the national life by such a course of training as will prepare them for the duties and privileges of American citizenship." Toward this end, Indian youths needed to be taught the fundamental principles of democratic government, the institutional and political structure of American society, the rights of citizens under the Constitution, and the role and sanctity of law in a democratic society. Beyond this, education for citizenship involved the delicate business of instilling a deep devotion to the nation and its flag. The Indian student would have to study American history and, in the process, come to internalize the national myths that were central to it, including the idea that the westward sweep of the American Empire, that is to say, the dispossession of Indian land, was clearly justifiable. In this connection, the Indian student must be taught the terms upon which Indian and white societies had confronted one another, savagism versus civilization, and that the only hope for the race's survival was for it to join the march of historical progress. Granted, all this called for an artful use of schooling as an instrument for furthering the process of white, political, and ideological hegemony. But philanthropists were convinced they could pull it off. These constituted the main ends of Indian schooling. All in all, the Indian child was to be totally transformed, all vestiges of his former self eradicated. As superintendent of Indian schools, John Riley expressed it, "The Indian child was a prickly thorn that must be made to bear roses. He is a twig bent out of the perpendicular, and he must be straightened so that the tree will stand erect, inclining in no way. He is a vessel of bronze that must be made bright by constant rubbing." It was a noble undertaking, to be sure, one worthy of reformers' efforts. An army of school teachers. The connection between education and civilized progress received a dramatic visual treatment in 1872 in a painting by John Gast. Issued a year later as a chromolithograph under the title American Progress, and now accompanied by a short explanatory text, this popular print constituted a vivid rendering of American civilization's sweep across the continent. Center stage in the print is given to Columbia, a virtual goddess of progress who floats westward over the American landscape. Behind her, on the eastern seaboard, are depictions of the advanced technology and commercial empire, civilization. Directly below her, at mid-continent, are the symbols of an advancing civilization, the frontiersmen and yeoman farmers who will tame the wilderness and plow the prairies. As for the goddess, close examination reveals that her forehead is decorated by a star, which, the text explains, is the Star of Empire. With one hand, she stretches westward the telegraph wire, a powerful symbol of advancing technology and national unity. With the other, she clutches a large volume to her bosom. It is only when an observer turns to the left of the print, to the expanse of territory still beyond the reach of Columbia's influence, that one sees the triumph of American progress is not without its tragic dimension. Here, Native Americans are depicted as the pathetic remnants of a vanishing race retreating before the rush of civilization. As the text explains, they are fleeing from progress and towards the blue waters of the Pacific. All they can do is turn their despairing faces as they flee from the presence of the wondrous vision. The star is too much for them. 10 years later, American progress was still a vivid expression of the meaning of the American experience, a visual rendering of an essentially moral tale, the triumph of Christian civilization over a savage land and people. But now, reformers would have altered the print in one significant respect. The Indian need not vanish from the face of the earth. The answer was in the book that Columbia clutched to her breast, for upon closer inspection, the book contains the inscription, Common School. If fleeing Indians would but accept the gift of the book, if Columbia would but offer it to them, they might be civilized and thus saved from extinction. And so it was time to build schools, and Congress built them. In 1877, Congress began appropriating funds expressly for the purpose of Indian education. The figures tell the story. 1877, $20,000. 1880, $75,000. 1885, $992,800. 1890, $1,364,568. 1895, $2,060,695. And 1900, $2,936,080. The figures on school enrollment are also revealing. 1877, 3,598. 1880, 4,651. 1885, 8,143. 1890, 12,232. 1895, 18,188. And 1900, 21,568. A related measure is the percentage of the Indian school-age population actually provided for. Whereas the Indian Office estimated in 1884 that only 1/4 of Indian children were provided for, by 1890, the figure had grown to half. By 1920, 70%. And by 1926, nearly 83%. Little wonder that missionary Annie Beecher Scoville would observe in 1901, "If there is an idol that the American people have, it is the school. What gold is to the miner, the schoolhouse is to the Yankee. If you don't believe it, go out to Pine Ridge and find planted over the stretch of territory 32 schoolhouses standing there as testimony to our belief in education. There is something whimsical in planting schoolhouses where no man can read, far from the highways, unneighbored by farms, and planted not at the request of the Sioux, but because we believed it was good for them. It is a remedy for barbarism, we think, and so we give the dose. Uncle Sam is like a man setting a charge of powder. The school is the slow match. He lights it and goes off whistling, sure that in time it will blow up the old life. And of its shattered pieces, he will make good citizens." The war against Indians had now entered a new phase. Conquering a continent and its aboriginal peoples had been a bloody business and, for a Christian people, not without moral discomfort. Now the war against savagism would be waged in gentler fashion. The next Indian war would be ideological and psychological, and it would be waged against children. Thus, Merrill Gates, president of the Lake Mohonk Conference, declared in 1891 that the time for fighting the Indian tribes is past. What was needed now was an army of Christian school teachers. That is the army that is going to win the victory. We are going to conquer barbarism, but we are going to do it by getting at the barbarism one by one. We are going to do it by the conquest of the individual man, woman, and child, which leads to the truest civilization. We are going to conquer the Indians by a standing army of schoolteachers armed with ideas, winning victories by industrial training, and by the gospel of love and the gospel of work. It all seemed so simple. Cannot civilization civilize? The former Commissioner of Indian Affairs, George E. Ellis, asked in 1882. Like other reformers, believed that it could. The answer lay in education. Chapter 2. Models. It was one thing to conclude that schools were the solution to the Indian problem, and quite another to determine the manner in which Indian children should be schooled. For at least a decade, policymakers focused their attention on a single question. How much institutional hegemony was it necessary to establish over the child to accomplish his transformation? Although the issue would never be completely resolved to the satisfaction of all, by the end of the 1880s, an answer had emerged. The path to this resolution, or rather compromise, can be traced by analyzing policymakers' successive enthusiasm for three institutions: the reservation day school, the reservation boarding school, and the off-reservation boarding school. The most elemental approach was the reservation day school, located on the outskirts of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.